Ya viene la revolución, para que se asustan será para mejor. Es el pueblo entero el que ya está gritando, ¡viva la revolución!
Iranian nuclear weapons development.
They have turned the island into a communist hellhole.
The experiment in Venezuela has failed completely.
La bestialidad imperialista. Bestialidad que no tiene una frontera determinada ni pertenece a un país determinado. Bestias fueron las hordas hitleristas, como bestias son los norteamericanos hoy, como bestias son los paracaidistas belgas, como bestias fueron los imperialistas franceses en Argelia. Porque es la naturaleza del imperialismo la que bestializa a los hombres, la que la convierte en fieras sedientas de sangre que están dispuestas a degollar, a asesinar, a destruir hasta la última imagen de un revolucionario, de un partidario de un régimen que haya caído bajo su bota o que luche por su libertad. Y la estatua que recuerda a Lumumba, hoy destruida, pero mañana reconstruida, nos recuerda también en la historia trágica de ese mártir de la revolución del mundo, que no se puede confiar en el imperialismo, pero ni tantito así, nada.
Святую свободу, на бой кровавый, святой праздник. long live the Soviet Union, long live Marxism, Leninism, communism, long live the peoples of Russia, Donbass, Donetsk, Luhansk, Crimea, money for jobs and education, not wars and occupation, hands off Russia, no to NATO, no to fascism, don't fall for the lies, please, not this time. Remember Iraq, remember Libya, remember Afghanistan, you know, let's not get into another war. So this is an urgent call. What's up, everybody? Welcome to episode 64, Unmasking Imperialism, Exposing Imperialist Propaganda in Mainstream Media. Today, in defense of Donbass, in defense of Russia, and in defense of all anti-fascist communists against imperialism, against empire, against racism. And today we're going to be exposing mainstream media coverage of the so-called Russia-Ukraine conflict. I don't like to call it that because that's what it's called in mainstream media, and it gives it a false portrayal, a false comparison, but that's what it's being called in mainstream media. We're going to talk about some of the imperialist lies about the liberation of Donbass from Ukrainian fascism. We're also going to discuss the need to stand in solidarity with the peoples of Donbass, which is a region of greater Russia in quote-unquote eastern Ukraine, which includes Donetsk and Luhansk, people's republics, and also the Russian people against empire. And as communists based in the United States, in the belly of the beast, and the empire that is creating this conflict, we say, we unite around these demands. Hands off Russia. No to NATO. No to Ukrainian fascism. Solidarity with our sisters and brothers in Donbass. And as I mentioned earlier, money for jobs and education, not wars and occupation. There's plenty of shit that we need to address here in the U.S., poverty, declining healthcare, gas price, so many problems that we need to address first before even thinking about getting involved in Ukraine and Russia. Joining me today are two great comrades, comrade Chris Durán, my homie from New Jersey. Chris is a student and community organizer working with Free Them All New Jersey. He also works with several other campaigns to free U.S. held political prisoners and prisoners of war. Chris is a first-year graduate student at the Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies at NYU. And Chris also has Soviet roots, Ukrainian roots, revolutionary roots, and Chilean roots as well. How's it going, compañero Chris Durán?
Peace, man. You know, it's been a long day, but I'm blessed to be here and, you know, be with some comrades that, you know, and talk about this is very needed today. So,
most definitely. Thank you for joining, Chris. I'm sure being in New York and NYU and the city, probably a lot of liberals who are freaking out about everything. It must have been crazy. So we'll get into that in a bit. Also joining us is comrade Mitch Jones. Mitch is an editor of Midwestern Marks. Shout out to Midwestern Marks. Please like, subscribe, support Midwestern Marks. Really great dudes, really great comrades who are producing some amazing communist content. And the Journal of American Socialist Studies. Mitchell is a public health worker, historian, and member of the Party for Socialism and Liberation in Rochester, New York. Shout out to PSL. And Mitch has a bachelor's degree in anthropology and a master's degree in history. How's it going, comrade Mitch?
It's going good. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for having me on. I'm excited to talk about this important topic. I know a lot of us have maybe been having discussions online. The rad lib horde is out in full force right now. So yep. It's an important time to have these conversations.
Most definitely. And I think conversation is a nice way of putting it, man. It's crazy just to hear like just some of the shit that people are saying. By the way, shout out to everybody who's watching and listening. Shout out to comrade Erica Kane. Shout out to comrade Salifu, to Bird Worldist, to Vanessa, to comrade B-Level, to everybody who's watching, to compañero Gustavo, to Steven, to everybody who's watching and listening. Please like and share. Also, comrade Anderson. Shout out to comrade Anderson. Long live the Donetsk People's Republic and Luhansk People's Republic. Yeah, it's been a crazy day. So I work construction. I'm on a construction site 8 hours a day. And I don't really check my phone that much because, you know, we're always working with our hands and shit. So everybody's been hitting me up today, like, yo, what's going on with Russia and Ukraine? Like, what are your thoughts on this? I haven't really been following it until, like, just now, like an hour or two ago. Obviously, I'm familiar with the years leading up to what's going on. But so much has happened within the last 24 hours that I felt like I wanted to have this conversation in the stream. Because, man, everybody, even so-called, quote-unquote, leftist communists, are falling for the spell that, you know, Russia's evil, Putin is evil. It's part of his great master plan to take over Ukraine. And it's just insane. And it's really sad to see people falling for this over and over. And then there's even some commentators like Kyle Kalinske and other social democrats or liberals, rad libs, who are playing the fence sitting, you know, neither Moscow nor Washington, this middle road, which is taking a position, right? Like even calling it Russia-Ukraine conflict is taking a position. So, you know, we wanted to have this conversation from the belly of the beast, from the U.S. to talk about, you know, even though this is happening like thousands and thousands of miles away, what is our role as communists, as Marxist-Leninists in the belly of the beast to do? Our role is to oppose war, oppose empire, right? It's not up to us to decide how ideologically pure the Luhansk or Donetsk movements are, right? It's our role to recognize that there's this real threat of fascism that for many years has been killing, wiping out ethnic Russians and other peoples as well in Eastern Ukraine, in that region, just for allying with Russia, just for being against fascism and racism and against NATO. So it's really important and urgent to have this conversation. And just, it's really sad to see how many people are falling for the whole spell. It's a spell that's going on, you know? So we wanted to have this conversation. So what I want to do is just to kind of kick off what's going on. What I want to do is I'm going to play a clip of Putin announcing the operation to liberate Donetsk and Luhansk. So just to give an extremely quick crash course into what's going on before I play this. Basically, in 2014, there was a fascist coup in Ukraine. It was dubbed the Euromaidan in Western liberal media. They used these hipsters playing the piano and giving flowers to the soldier. You know, all the elements of the color revolutions were involved in that, right? And they overthrew President Yanukovych, not necessarily a leftist or anything, but he was more friendly to Russia, right? More friendly to Russia and China. They overthrew him. And basically, the EU came in. All these fascist groups like the Azov Battalion came in and basically launched this campaign against people who they deemed Russian separatists. You have to remember that Ukraine borders Russia, so there's a large history of Russians being in the land called Ukraine. And actually, the groups of people today who are Russians come from Kiev, which is the capital of Ukraine, the Kievan Rus civilization, thousands of years. So the roots of the Russian people are deeply connected to Ukraine, one and the same. They're interconnected, right? So basically, in this 2014 coup, you had this fascist government that comes in. They're waving Confederate flags. They're waving Nazi flags. They're killing anybody who's suspected of being Russian, of being communist. They ban communist parties. They ban the hammer and sickle. So if I was rocking, hold on, where's my tattoo? If I was rocking this tattoo in Ukraine, they'd probably snipe me down and kill me. It's crazy. So Ukraine basically has this fascist government since 2014. And every day since then, these two provinces, Luhansk and Donetsk, which in their totality comprise Donbass, they're called Donbass, who are recognized by Russia. They are Russian people. They want to reunite with Russia. They've been completely encircled. They've been attacked. They've been sniped. They've been shot. So many horrible things that have been happening to them since then. And so basically, you know, basically what has happened in these days and weeks leading up, every single day, the U.S. is like, Putin is going to invade. Putin's going to invade. Putin's going to invade. Putin's going to invade. And beating the drums of war. Meanwhile, the Ukrainian military and the Ukrainian fascist paramilitaries as well, they've been intensifying shooting, attacks, all these horrible atrocities against the people of Donetsk and Luhansk, creating a situation where it's so horrible. We haven't been hearing about that. And Putin's like, you know what? We got to send in our guys to help these people out because they're literally being killed. They're being sniped down. We're going to play some clips later of testimony of people in Donbass actually talking about that. And so basically, This is Putin announcing a special operations mission in Donbass to help these Russians and working class poor people who are under attack by the Ukrainian fascist government. So I'll just play this short clip.
With accordance to the Article 51 in the 7th chapter of the UN Charter, with the sanction of the Federation Council, and according to the Friendship and Mutual Help Treaties with Donetsk and Luhansk Republics, I have decided to conduct a special military operation. The goal is to protect the people who, for 8 years, suffer bullying and genocide from the Kiev regime. And for this, we aim for the demilitarization and denazification of Ukraine. We'll bring to the court those who committed multiple sanguinary crimes against civilians, including Russian citizens. We do not plan to occupy Ukrainian territories.
So again, right, Putin is saying, we're not going to occupy, we're going in to defend our people, to denazify these regions. And it's crazy because mainstream media is painting Putin as Hitler and as a fascist and all this, but he's literally helping to fight the real fascists, right? And he talked about the ears of humiliation. Before I turn it over to the comrades who are on, I want to just play this clip of Biden reacting to what happened, you know, being all fucking crazy as he normally is. Who even knows if he knows what's going on? He probably just had some cue cards or talking points or a headset. So I'm going to play Biden's reaction and then we'll get into some analysis of what's going on.
Putin has committed an assault on the very principles that uphold the global peace. But now the entire world sees clearly what Putin and his Kremlin and his Kremlin allies are really all about. This was never about a genuine security concerns on their part. It was always about naked aggression, about Putin's desire for empire by any means necessary, by bullying Russia's neighbors through coercion and corruption, by changing borders by force, and ultimately by choosing a war without a cause. Putin's actions betray his sinister vision for the future of our world, one where nations take what they want by force. But it is a vision that the United States and freedom-loving nations everywhere will oppose with every tool of our considerable power. The United States and our allies and partners will emerge from this stronger, more united, more determined, and more purposeful. And Putin's aggression against Ukraine will end up costing Russia dearly, economically and strategically. We will make sure of that. Putin will be a pariah on the international stage. Any nation that countenances Russia's naked aggression against Ukraine will be stained by association. When the history of this era is written, Putin's choice to make a totally unjustifiable war on Ukraine will have left Russia weaker and the rest of the world stronger. Liberty, democracy, human dignity, these are the forces far more powerful than fear and oppression. They cannot be extinguished by tyrants like Putin and his armies. They cannot be erased by people from people's hearts and hopes by any amount of violence and intimidation. They endure. In the contest between democracy and autocracy, between sovereignty and subjugation, make no mistake, freedom will prevail. God bless the people of a free and democratic Ukraine. May God protect our troops.
He probably shit his pants, had to change his diaper, Sleepy Joe. And Chris said, Biden's dentures beating his ass. Biden, no idea, man. Part of me feels bad for him because he's probably like, man, what the fuck am I doing here? Like, I'm not even supposed to be doing this. But just a lot of nonsense. Everything is aimed at Putin. He just woke up one morning and his desire for empire and his aggression just suddenly make him attack Ukraine. So, Chris, your analysis view of what's been going on and any have you had any conversations with people about what's going on?
Well, I think, first of all, obviously this thing is very personal for me. You know, my mother grew up in the Soviet Union. She grew up in the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic. She moved here about, you know, in like 1995, which was like in the middle of, again, the fact that people don't appreciate the disaster that was caused in multiple countries and also globally by the fall of the Soviet Union just in a material sense, is amazing. So, yeah, I think, honestly, first of all, the hypocrisy of Biden is, you know, just very obvious, you know, for him, again, to stand up and talk about freedom and all this type of shit. And the fact that, you know, does anyone know how many countries the U.S. has bombed within the last 3 days? You know, does anybody care? And Biden was also a huge supporter and instigator of the coup in Ukraine. I also have thoughts on the fact that people talk about Trump and stopping fascism, but it's this liberal president that's advancing fascism globally. And I also have thoughts on the fact that, I don't know, for me personally, like, my mom always taught me that, like, the people in my family who were in the Red Army who fought the Nazis in World War II were heroes and were to be respected. So to see this sort of fascist takeover and split of Ukraine on nationalist and ethnic, you know, lines is very, you know, it's very depressing to see. And seeing the United States doing essentially what has been the West's dream for a couple centuries now. I mean, Napoleon tried to get at the East, Hitler tried to get at the East, you know, going through Ukraine, going through the resource rich, you know, country of Ukraine. And again, you know, just seeing that this sort of centuries long legacy that, you know, the West has had for, you know, trying to take over, you know, trying to take over Russia and trying to, you know, and get through there is somewhat, you know, it's like we're back in the same position and without much of a basis now, because now Ukrainians, like you said, the left in Ukraine is kind of disavowed. And now they're kind of placed into this like dichotomy of, oh, you're pro Putin or you're pro. And it's like, you know, that's, it's like, no, I mean, it's a basic fact that, you know, the best material benefits for Ukrainians would be in alliance with the East and not with fucking NATO or the European Union or the United States. And there was a free and democratic Ukraine at one point, and that was destroyed in 1991. So
beautifully said. And it's crazy because, like, so many of the anti-fascist resistance fighters who defeated the Nazis were Ukrainian, and Ukrainian women in particular, who were amazing snipers. And the anti-fascist spirit still lives on in eastern Ukraine and Donetsk and Luhansk. And it's crazy to see, like, I don't like to say that history repeats itself, but history rhymes. And I feel like we're at a time similar to the early 20th century where you have this rising fascism and now growing resistance to that. So it's interesting to see that. Comrade Mitch, you know, your analysis, what has been going on? I was by the way, shout out to compañero Carlos Garrido, who from Midwestern Marx. He's and Comrade Eddie as well. I was talking to Carlos earlier on text, and he was like, yo, Mitch is the man to talk to. He was going off on people. He was like, you know, laying down the law. What has been your interactions like with people around this whole situation and your analysis of what's going on?
Yeah, the comment sections have been a bit disappointing in some of the posts. I know there's like a anti-fascist that I follow from Portland who said something about that Zelensky is Jewish, so obviously Ukraine can't be Nazi, you know, and so all this kind of stuff. So there's been a lot of pushback from, you know, and then AOC put out a statement and Bernie put out a statement about Putin's yacht, which, you know, was ridiculous. So, it's been disappointing, the response from a lot of people. But I do want to get out of the way, you know, in the first place. Putin made a statement, I think it was yesterday, maybe it was today, but he said something about that Ukraine was kind of a mistake of Lenin and Stalin, that Lenin and Stalin made the mistake of respecting self-determination and having federalism in the Soviet Union. I would certainly differ from Putin in that position. Lenin and Stalin did not make a mistake with having federalism. And in fact, self-determination of nations, you know, was one of the cornerstones of the Soviet Union. Lenin said, no nation can be free if it oppresses other nations, said Marx and Engels. He said, full of a sense of national pride, we great Russian workers want, come what may, a free and independent, democratic, republican, and proud great Russia, one that will base its relations with its neighbors on the human principle of equality and not on the feudalist principle of privilege, which is so degrading to a great nation. So, you know, so I would certainly differ with Putin on those statements. Putin is not a communist, you know, as much as Tony Blinken, Secretary of State, is saying that Putin wants to bring back the Soviet Union. That's not the case. But what is the reality here is that the people of Donbass have called upon the Russians because they've been consistently shelled for months. Well, consistently shelled since 2014, but in the past months, it's really amped up. And, you know, loss of power, loss of water, groups like the Azov Battalion, which has been absorbed into the Ukrainian National Guard. A lot of people don't realize that the Azov Battalion is, in fact, a Nazi division of the official government Ukrainian National Guard. And they've been attacking people in Luhansk and in Donetsk and, you know, and not just, I mean, you know, not to get too graphic, but some of their crimes that they've done in that region are horrific: torture, rape, you know, targeting of LGBT, Muslim, communist, Russian-speaking individuals, right? So this is a pretty horrific situation, and the so-called hashtag resistance to the so-called fascist Trump, right, have been arming and training and giving money to actual, you know, you can't even call them neo-Nazis because they're actually original Nazis, right?
Yeah.
You know, so you know, one of the things Biden said was that the sovereignty of a nation is important over, you know, we need to respect sovereignty over subjugation of a nation. Lenin and Stalin would agree with that, right? Absolutely. That's they wrote extensively on that issue, right? Donbass has a right to self-determination, and they voted, 90% of people voted for the establishment of independent republics in Luhansk and Donetsk in November of 2014. And that's something that's forgotten a lot. A lot of people don't realize that, right? So this has been a region that's been ramping up tensions since 2014. I would say I am a little bit disappointed by Putin's decisions to launch attacks on the inner part of Ukraine, but I understand that the bombs have targeted military targets. They've been miles outside of civilian areas, right? So this is a warning signal, basically, at this point, right? The response from the U.S. has been to increase sanctions, which have already been an issue, you know, with Russia ongoing. I think one of the things that's important to mention here is the Nord Stream 2 pipeline, which is a pipeline through the Baltic Sea. There's already the Nord Stream pipeline, but they were building another one, a pipeline through the Baltic Sea to get natural gas and oil to Europe, especially Germany and France, who basically rely on Russian petroleum products. Yeah, exactly. So here it is. Now there is another pipeline that goes through. I'm trying to figure. I forget the name of the other one, but there's another pipeline that goes through Ukraine, and there's an issue with that pipeline is that Russia and Ukraine have disputed the fees as far as the use of that pipeline. So I think what Russia would like is to not have to go through Ukraine to get oil and natural gas to Europe. Yeah. So the transit fees, there's been a, that's what it is, the transit fees. And this is the Druzhba pipeline, that goes through Ukraine and Belarus. Ukraine has demanded usage fees from that pipeline. So Russia has tried to subvert that by creating the Nord Stream 2 pipeline. And that the building and the deals with Germany to build that pipeline have halted as a result of all of this. So I mentioned also the United States announced more sanctions. Canada has also signed on to that, and I think the UK maybe too as well. That's going to cause a lot of problems for Europe because they're going to have to decide whether or not they want to do that. Macron, the president of France, was in talks with Putin. Those talks apparently, sort of didn't really go too far. But I think European countries are very, very much aware that the people are going to suffer from this. And the people from the United States are going to suffer from this as well. The price of gasoline is going to go up. And when we talk about sanctions, they say, oh, well, it's a peaceful means of achieving regime change. Well, sanctions don't target the regime. Sanctions target the people. And it's going to cause suffering on the part of the Russian people. So that's something I think we need to understand about the whole situation. And also that this whole tragedy is entirely preventable. Russia made demands saying that NATO must not expand. NATO must halt their activities in Donbass and the disputed regions. In Crimea and between Ukraine and Russia, and the United States refused to do that. And in fact, instead of refusing to do that, they've escalated and ramped up tensions and made it clear they want war. So they wanted a war, and it appears they got what they desired.
That's such a great rundown of what's going on, Mitch. And I'm glad you mentioned the economics of it. I think a lot of times in mainstream media, there's a lot of smoke and mirrors, right? A lot of the propaganda out now is making it seem like this is Putin's long-awaited dream and fantasy. The liberal idea of the great men of history, that events happen because of individual people and individual desires, which is a very metaphysical liberal way of understanding the world. But as Marxists, as communists, we understand that material conditions determine the situations and the circumstances of reality. And economics ultimately have a leading central role, the base, right? The base and the superstructure. Events taking place in the superstructure are determined by the base. And what is the economic base? You hit it right now, exactly, talking about the oil crisis, the fact that you have these US multinational oil companies that are losing their grip on power, ExxonMobil, Chevron, Shell, BP, these international banking, Wall Street, London liberal stock exchange elites, they see Russia as a competitor. And Russia is a very resource-rich country with natural gas and provides it to other countries through its exports. Now, if you own the media, let's say you're Chevron or BP or ExxonMobil, and you own the most powerful media outlets in the world, and your competitor has something that you want, you're obviously going to use those media outlets to portray a certain narrative, to beat the drums of war, to create a demonized figure, a boogeyman, to provoke this sort of conflict. And a lot of times, you know, people say like, oh, are you a Putin apologist? Like, no, there's many things that I don't agree with. I think it's important to recognize that the people of Donbass, of Russia, it's their right to determine their path for what they want. They don't want war. They don't want conflict. And we have to respect that. And I think the economics plays such a big role in what's actually going on. It's not just Putin's fantasy and him waking up. And I think we have to get beyond that, you know, and it's a very elementary way of viewing things. But you mentioned Azov Battalion, and I think that's one of the names that is barely getting any coverage in mainstream media. people don't even know that the Ukrainian government that's in place now came to power in a fascist coup, and the Azov Battalion, a far-right Nazi organization, is one of the leading groups that has been killing and murdering people in Donbass. So what I want to do is I want to play a clip. Interestingly enough, by the way, this is from Time. So, you know, again, not a friend of the working class and bourgeois media itself. This is from almost 2 years ago. This is before things were heating up, when the Donbass conflict was kind of, quote unquote, winding down. So it's interesting to see that even bourgeois media themselves admit that you have literal fascists in the Ukrainian government, and now they're kind of like wiping that under the fridge and trying to hide that. So I'm going to play this clip just to give some more background on Azov, and we'll talk about the nature of Ukrainian fascism.
Violent extremism have grown especially alarmed about the Azov movement. The group emerged from the revolution that swept across Ukraine in 2014, and it has gotten a lot stronger amid the ongoing war with pro-Russian forces in eastern Ukraine. The fighting in that region has become kind of ideal breeding ground for militias like Azov. At their public events, one thing that surprised me was how many Ukrainians tend to see Azov not as militants or extremists, but as war heroes. In Kyiv, the capital, I watched an Independence Day parade where veterans of the Azov Battalion marched alongside other volunteer militias, surrounded by cheering crowds who thanked them for defending Ukraine against Russia. But even at the march, there were signs of the far-right ideology that's so common inside Azov. The symbols on their flags have been especially controversial. Azov says it combines the letters I and N for idea of nation, but extremism experts see it as an emblem of Nazism.
The official symbol of Azov, it's a version of Wolfsangel. It was one of the symbols of one of SS division during the World War II. It is one of more or less usual symbols for neo-Nazi groups all over the world.
And it's not just about their symbols. When it was founded in 2014, Azov drew many of its commanders and recruits from Ukraine's most notorious far-right groups, including outright neo-Nazis.
We basically recruited everyone who could hold weapons in their hand when Ukrainian state was paralyzed and the defense of Ukrainian state was totally in the hand of Ukrainian volunteers. So there were many war adventurers, guys who believed that they are on a kind of ideological tour to save maybe the future of the West and so on and so forth. So
the future of the white race?
Yes.
Azov's paramilitary wing is now a major fighting force, with its own bases and training grounds near the front lines of the war against pro-Russian forces. After the veterans parade in Kyiv, I interviewed Andrei Biletsky, who founded the Azov movement in 2014.
Воинское братство — это люди, которые не просто служили вместе, вместе проливали кровь, переживали гибель товарищей, сладость побед, охраны общественного порядка на улице. Мы создаем отряды самообороны, которые помогают поддерживать порядок на улицах.
Azov's leaders have also tried to break into politics. They failed to win any seats in parliament during the most recent elections in 2019, but their plans in Ukraine are ambitious.
Сьогодні ми відпочиваємо, але навіть відпочиваючи, ми пропагуємо наші нові українські цінності. Бути сильними і сміливими, бути єдиними і відчувати братерство своєї нації.
What worries officials in the West is Azov's recruitment strategy. It's tried hard to build friendships with far-right groups around the world, especially in the US and Europe. During my visit in 2019, I spent a day at one of the biggest recruitment events in Azov's history. Thousands of people showed up for a day of fighting sports and blatant propaganda. There were neo-Nazi symbols, tattoos, and posters all over the place.
So that's a little bit about the Azov Battalion. Apparently they also, I guess Nazis like to rave as well and wrestle and do all these random things. But Azov Battalion, not a good group of guys, really horrible people, fascists, literal Nazis who have been killing and murdering innocent peoples in eastern Ukraine. Really horrible. Comrade Chris, I wanted to ask you, you know, give us your thoughts about the origins of Ukrainian fascism, because what I find interesting is that one of the main sources of influence of the Azov Battalion and the Ukrainian Fascists is Stepan Bandera. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it right, but he was this far-right leader who basically sided with the Nazis during World War II. Give us some breakdown about, like, even just in within Ukraine, like, what are some of the class and divisions between, like, the Western Ukraine that some elements sided more with the Nazis, and then the Eastern part of Ukraine that had a lot of Russian and anti-fascist and Soviet revolutionaries?
Yeah, so that's a very long, complicated history, but basically, you know, basically immediately right after, like, the Bolshevik Revolution, the United States and other Western countries immediately started backing groups in Ukraine and other countries that were far right, that were, you know, the sort of like narrow nationalist mindset. And they did so throughout World War II. Again, like you referenced, the Nazis backed Bandera and this Ukrainian nationalist front, which ended up actually aiding in the genocide committed by the Germans, by the Nazis in Ukraine, massacring thousands of Poles, thousands of Russians, thousands of Jews, and Roma people. And yeah, so in largely, you know, this was largely concentrated in the western part of the country. And so, like, areas like Kharkiv and Lvov is, you know, very nationalist oriented in. And I think, I mean, if we go back to, you know, the sort of communist readings, nationalism within the sort of European sense usually turns out to be very imperialist minded and, you know, white centered and, you know, the sort of white supremacist purity, you know, idea. And, but yeah, the East was always much more like mixed with Russians. And there's also a long historical, you know, process of how that happened within the empire. Yeah, you had two options. You either had, you know, the option of this nationalist project that is based around this myth of what a Ukrainian is, and you had the idea of everyone should live in a socialist republic that is, you know, based in internationalism. And you know, fortunately, you know, after the Bolshevik Revolution, after World War II, you know, the Soviet Union won, and you know, Bandera, you know, and his nationalists, and also nationalists in Russia and other countries, also lost, and didn't get to sell out the country. But the fact is, after 1991, when the country was sold out, when all these countries were sold out, and you know, to the West, and corporations from the United States started owning the resources in these countries, and the state was completely dismantled and everything was privatized, you know, these nationalist forces are what, you know, were empowered by the state at that point. You know, after 1991 in Ukraine, they banned unions with radical characteristics. They, you know, tried to marginalize any left forces in the country, and they actively empowered, you know, the right wing. And, you know, that's how you get the coup that happened in 2014. And that's how you get where we are now, where Stepan Bandera is literally hailed as a national hero, which is, again, given the history of Ukraine anti-fascism, you know, not just in the East, but throughout the entire country, is pretty disgusting.
Yeah, most definitely. And I think that's a great rundown of the history of Ukrainian fascism and how it's basically operated as a henchmen for NATO, for imperialism, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, or terrorist organization, as I like to call it. And even just looking at a map of Ukraine, it's interesting. So Donetsk, Luhansk are all the way on the east. You can probably see Luhansk, like, right at the very far right, right next to Russia. So it's literally, like, right there, right? Russia has a huge border with Ukraine. And the interesting thing about even just looking at a map and how ridiculous, because all of the narratives and talking points in mainstream media is Russia is mobilizing thousands of troops along the Ukrainian border. That's some of the word magic that has been used, right? Along the Ukrainian border. Well, what's along the Ukrainian border is Russia is its own country. So Russia is mobilizing troops within its own country. A country has the right to do that, obviously, within its own borders, right? They're mobilizing troops. And can you imagine if it was the U.S.? Like, I live in SoCal, in Southern California. I live in L.A., not too far from San Diego, which is on the border between the U.S. and Mexico. Every day, there are U.S. troops mobilizing on the Mexican border because they're in San Diego. And by the way, San Diego in Southern California is stolen lands from Mexico anyway to begin with. So you don't see that same kind of rhetoric used when it's the U.S. military, but when it's Russia, it's horrible, it's evil, and they're planning an evil takeover. So, you know, Comrade Mitch, your thoughts on fascism, the roots of fascism in Ukraine, and also connected to, like, you know, one thing that I find really interesting is, like, that I call it, like, hipster fascism, is how a lot of these coups and color revolutions in the 21st century, they have the aesthetic, the appearance of being free-loving and hippies, and we're just about democracy. You know, Euromaidan, we saw that, right? 2011 coup against Gaddafi, you know, it was this pro-democracy people, and they ended up being like far-right Wahhabis and involved in trading enslaved Africans, Libyans. You know, tell us a little bit of, like, your thoughts on this kind of collaboration between these liberal hipster imperialists and actual fascists. I think Ukraine is such a great example of that.
Yeah. Of moderate rebels, and I think that's especially relevant, you know, in recent memory, especially as it connects to Russia, as far as in Syria. The United States was supporting the Al-Nusra Front, which was an organization that was organized by Al-Qaeda, which was the organization that did the 9/11 attacks, supposedly. So that, you know, it's very ironic that the United States is supporting these so-called moderates who, you know, oftentimes, you know, end up turning their weapons against the United States, and it becomes a problem for the United States as well. I think we use this term color revolution a couple times. So a color revolution, Ukraine had the Orange Revolution in 2004. That was the first sort of color revolution in Ukraine, and that was a series of protests that that demanded a re-election, essentially. And accused the pro-Russian government at that time of being involved in massive corruption. This is a tactic that's been used all over the world, but, you know, the term color revolution kind of came to describe the revolution supported by the United States and their allies in the former Soviet bloc, so Yugoslavia, Georgia, Ukraine. We see the markings of a color revolution today in Ukraine. But I wanted to mention, going back to the fascism aspect, that symbol they brought up, that's the wolf's angle, right? And so the wolf's angle is it's really an ancient German rune. Based on a wolf trap. It's a part of the top part of the wolf trap. But it was used during World War II by the Nazis, several different 19. There was the most famously, I think, the second SS Panzer Division, Das Reich, and then the fourth SS Police Panzer Grenadier Division. So this was an SS symbol. Right. And there was a law passed in Ukraine in 2015. It was in April 2015. The Ukrainian parliament passed legislation. It was a decommunization law. However, the law, in order to attempt to sort of be fair to both sides and do a both sides kind of thing, banned communist symbols as well as Nazi symbols. However, apparently the wolf's angle was not among the symbols that was banned under that law. Now, continuing in 2015, in June of 2015, sorry, in July of 2015, the Ukrainian Interior Ministry made it illegal for the Communist Party of Ukraine, Communist Party of Ukraine Renewed, and the Communist Party of Workers and Peasants to participate in elections. So it made it illegal for communist, openly communist parties to be involved in elections. So, by the way, the wolf's angle there is in that middle flag on the right. There you see a Nazi flag, and on the left you see a NATO flag, right? So this is the Azov Battalion. That's there. That says Azov in Ukrainian there on their flag. So this group in November 2014 was absorbed into the actual Ukrainian National Guard, right? So the Azov Battalion is literally a battalion of the Ukrainian government, right? In 2014, the Euromaidan revolution, the second Ukrainian color revolution brought Poroshenko to power. Poroshenko is a right-wing nationalist. I don't know if you would consider him a neo-Nazi per se, but he had several members of Svoboda and Right Sector in his cabinet, filling ministry positions. They later resigned shortly after, actually, the Maidan Revolution. However, it's clear the character of that coup government was a far-right nationalist government that was at least okay with neo-Nazis being part of the government, right? We should, I mentioned that Zelensky is Jewish, right? And today we should mention that the neo-Nazi parties like Svoboda and Right Sector have less sway than they did in 2014 and 2015 in the government. However, like I said, they are still organized militias as part of the National Guard. I wanted to read a short thing from the Communist Party of the Russian Federation, their statement on the situation. They said, "Everyone should be aware that the democratic mechanisms in Ukraine have been abolished. After the 2014 state coup, real policy on its territory is increasingly dictated by aggressive nationalist bands. Representing an absolute terrorist minority, they hold Ukrainian people in fear and impose rules of behavior on members of political establishment. This accounts for the political transformation of Vladimir Zelensky, elected by Ukrainians as the president of peace in Donbass and normalizations of relations with Russia. He became a vehicle of the opposite kind of policy. In the current situation, the task of liberating Ukraine from Bandera dictatorship," referencing Stepan Bandera again there, "cannot be solved by the Ukrainian people itself. The country's civilian population is still partly able to express its opinion through what remains of parliamentary procedures, but it cannot oppose the forces of terror, which are armed to the teeth. The task of denazification of Ukraine must become the key concern of the world community." And it's important to note that in the 2019 Ukrainian parliament elections, the number one party was the party of Zelensky, which I forget the name of right now. I can't remember the Zelensky's party, but the second most popular party in the 2019 elections and the party that has the second most seats on that parliament is called the Opposition Platform. And the Opposition Platform is a pro-Russia party. Right. So there are many people, up until 2014, Ukraine went back and forth between having a pro-Russian president and a pro-Western, pro-EU president. Right. So they would go back and forth with this. 2014 kind of put an end to all that and forced them to continue to have a pro-Western government, even though a large percent of the people continue to be sympathetic to Ukraine or to Russia, and a lot of people speak Russian and have a familial feeling of a relationship with Russia.
Wow, really great information. And I like how you break down the connections between the Azov Battalion and the Ukrainian government, because a lot of times some liberals will say, oh, well, they're just some fringe group on the side. They have nothing to do with this peaceful liberal hipster movement, and they're part and parcel of it. I found this really interesting poster. This is for, I haven't seen this film myself. I can tell I hate it already. It's called Winter on Fire, Ukraine's Fight for Freedom. And I feel like this poster perfectly exemplifies modern propaganda of the 21st century. It exemplifies the new strategy of imperialism. You have, this is an image from the 2014 fascist coup, right, against Yanukovych. And you have a child, right, what looks like a young girl wearing a head wrap, a traditional Ukrainian head wrap with the yellow and blue. So you have the color, right? You have her in the traditional garb, looking innocent with her hands down and open, and looking at the, and then in the background, you have these faceless, cold, steel guard shielded police with no faces, no names, nothing, just authoritarian autocrats holding onto power. And it's just, this is propaganda. This is imperialism of the 21st century. This is propaganda. And what's crazy is how many people on the left fall for it. Like, it's insane. It's so infuriating. And that's why it's important to have conversations like these, because we don't need another Iraq weapons of mass destruction. We don't need another Libya when they said that Gaddafi was quote unquote raping women and forcing and killing people. And it was all bullshit, you know, Syria, right? All the lies against President Assad, the chemical gas attack, and over and over and over. And it's like, this is how it seeps into the minds of the masses through Netflix. By the way, Netflix is owned, like, the owners is one of the relatives of Edward Bernays, who's like the father of modern propaganda, and had this whole book called Crystallizing Public Opinion about how to basically control minds into war. So it's fascinating, man, how propaganda and efficient it works. But, you know, to kind of counter that, what I want to do is I want to play a clip. This is from an interesting documentary, a new documentary from RT. And by the way, as soon as I say that, you're going to hear people, here we go, Russian propaganda, Russian state propaganda.
Oh, but you believe the Kremlin's line?
You're just towing Putin's line, you apologist. And, you know, and it's like I tell people, look, I watch everything, man. I watch fucking Fox, CNN, NBC, left, right. Everybody should watch everything. And watch RT. Just watch this documentary. Like, for people who are on the fence or don't know, just listen to actual Russian people, like, and people from Donbass speaking for themselves. Like, let them speak for themselves. Don't just go to Rachel Maddow and get your information from there. So I want to play a clip from this documentary about Donbass. This is what life is like for everyday people in Donbass, especially for Russian peoples who are under attack by the fascists every day. So just so you get a sense of what life is like in Donbass right now.
Миномети станки работают
на 8.
За посадкой где-то.
Выстрел!
Вон там вот делают посадки, и за посадкой там уже идет позиции ВСУ.
Возле остановки. Муж уже шел вот тут, за орехом тут упал.
Это мины хвост. Вот это мины.
Где ты это все берешь? Где ты это все нашла?
Это у нас было, а это у Натаси было.
Беспилот поднимает, я вижу его.
С собой прикрываем ту мирную жизнь, которая идет в Донецке.
Алло, я сейчас выезжаю. Да, выезжаю.
Все, я еду к вам. Ну, вот эти выходят. Посюда, посюда. Поехали.
Alexander Leontievich is one of the Grey Zone's most popular residents. He's the only electrician still here after civil war broke out in the settlement of Alexandrovka. For him, the front line starts just outside the gates of his own house.
Каждый божий день. И на Шевченко вчера тот 11 числа вызывали, то 10 числа я был. Там видите были провода, сделал. Тоже на лестнице пришлось лазить.
А чем перебили?
Ну, работают снайпера и скупрокалиберные каждый божий день. Это сегодня, за чего, что дождь вот это не было. А то, кажется, вчера стреляли ежедневно. Ежедневно стреляют скупрокалиберных, снайпера работают. Они в лесопосадке за ставком зашли, а это нейтральная зона. Категорически было запрещено им туда. Но они, что им не укажешь, что хотят, то и творят.
Alexander is the only one still willing to repair fire-damaged power lines. As he climbs high above the rooftops, he finds himself directly in the crosshairs of Ukrainian snipers.
So really powerful stuff. For those of you who are listening, weren't able to see, basically this man who's an electrician in Donbass, he's the last electrician there, and he climbs the power lines to maintain power for the people of Donbass. And every day he says that he's under threat by Ukrainian snipers who are trying to shoot him down. And every day the people of Donbass are surrounded. They're literally blockaded. Their whole area is blockaded by these fascists, by the Ukrainian government. And they're sniped down, they're bombed. These are the conditions that are on the ground now that is never mentioned in mainstream media. And that is the reason why this operation was called for to begin with. It's not that Putin just woke up and was like, I'm going to take over Ukraine. Haha. You know, it doesn't work like that. Like, these are people who are actually dying every day or being shot at, bombed, and they called Russia for help, and Russia is responding. And many of them have family in Russia. They're Russians themselves. And that's the sort of context that's completely missing from a lot of the corporate news. And that's why I tell people, like, don't just trust Western mainstream sources. A lot of people haven't even heard Russian speak for themselves. And it goes back to what we were talking about as well, like with their portrayal in movies. We've been programmed, right? This is all part of programming and brainwashing and propaganda, is that every bad guy in every movie is a Russian guy with a leather jacket smoking a cigarette or a ski mask and like, I'm going to kill you. Like, we've been brainwashed. And for people who think I'm crazy, like, no, like, look this shit up. Like, this is something that is all in imperialist strategy, psychological operation. We did, you know, me and Chris did an episode recently about psychological operations. Like, this is all a psyop to make us want to make people in the West try to get their consent for war. Because one of the things that you have to do as an imperialist, as a warmonger, you have to get consent, right? You can't just go in and invade people. You can't just go in, because otherwise you're going to lose the support. What is the best way to get people in support of your goals as a capitalist, as an imperialist? You have to scare the crap out of people. You have to use empathy, use emotions that people have naturally, and weaponize it, subvert it for empire. And that's exactly what they're doing in Russia, portraying, as Malcolm X said, they'll make you think that your friends are your enemies and your enemies are your friends. And this is exactly what I think is going on. But Comrade Chris, you know, maybe just your thoughts as we kind of wrap up here, your thoughts on what the situation is now. What do you think is going to happen next? And what do you think is the role of communists, of revolutionaries in the U.S. with all of this, the renewed threat of war going on?
I don't know. I mean, the thing is, like, the fact that people have, like, ignored these separatist movements and seeing it in its full context and ignore these bombings and this war that has been going on since 2014. And then everyone now wants to cry crocodile tears over Russia retaliating. I don't know. It says a lot about how, like, people here don't know and they don't want to know, and I don't feel like they really care. I think the only thing that, again, leftists or communists or revolutionaries here in the West can do is try to build, you know, try to build within their own communities and try to build, you know, political consciousness to counter this shit. And, you know, again, to, you know, build up that revolutionary base within the belly of the beast, because, like, this, the only position that people should be taking is opposition to the U.S.'s involvement in Ukraine and anywhere else in the world. It should not be commenting on what Russia is doing or telling them to get out of a situation that was created by the United States. So I have no idea where this is going to go from here. Hopefully, the one thing about, at least with Russian intervention, they say exactly what they're going to do.
Yeah.
It's a little bit different from the United States. You know, the United States, oh, we're not going to occupy, and then they end up occupying for 50 years. But, yeah. You know, I just think that, you know, if anything, this should be used to, like, heighten contradictions of why the United States needs to, you know, needs to die, because this shit is not, you know, this is not the fault of Russia or Ukraine at the end of the day. This is the fault of people manipulating a situation the same way that they go in and manipulate situations all around the world between different nationalities or ethnicities. That's what the imperialist system is. And unless people develop an idea of being anti-imperialist and not just being, you know, anti-war, or, you know, being anti-imperialist and not trying to make equivalencies between the United States and, like, other countries like China or Russia that doesn't actually really exist, then, you know, then I don't see too much progress out of that. So,
great point. And I think one thing I try to tell people when I have debates about Russia and Ukraine, I always try to keep my temper and try to be cool and collect, because I also don't want to be that crazy guy who's talking down at people like, you fucking idiot. Like, da-da. You know, I want to be cool about it. I'm like, you know, maybe you should consider looking at non-Western sources. Maybe you should look at this source or that source, right? And I think one way that I approach having this conversation with people is I like to ask people first, like, do you consider yourself a free thinker? Do you consider yourself somebody who likes to question and challenge authority? Most people are going to say yes, right? Nobody's going to be like, oh no, I follow exactly what, you know, mainstream media tells me. Most people like to think that they question authority, they question any dominant narratives, right? And now applying that to specific situations like Russia and Ukraine, like, okay, if you're a free thinker, if you're somebody who likes to question authority, why is it that your position aligns almost exactly with the establishment, with the ruling class, with MSNBC, CNN, with ExxonMobil, with NATO, with Biden, with Kamala? If you're such a free thinker, why do you have the same exact line as them? You know, and that kind of gets people thinking, right? Like, that's interesting. And I think that's sort of the conversations. I think it's important for all of us to have these conversations with people, and just, like, come at it, approach it from also a point of humility as well, because I'm not going to pretend I know everything about Donbass or Russia or Ukraine. Like, I'm still learning it. I'm still informing. My gut instinct, like, I already have a gut instinct that, okay, this is bullshit or this is kind of weird, you know, and I tend to follow my gut a lot. That happened as well in Syria. Like, you guys remember 2014, like, people, even within the left, there was a lot of debate. I remember some Trotskyist groups were, like, attacking me and shit, like, verbally. They were like, you're an Assad apologist, you know, because I didn't want, I went to a hands-off Syria action. And, like, you know, so it was interesting, even within the left. But you have to follow your gut, take a position, and don't be cowardly. Don't be cowardly, because that's the shit that pisses me off, is, like, when people know that it's bullshit, or, you know, that this is leading up to war, like, don't be cowardly. Stand your position, even if it's unpopular. If it's the correct position, stand by it. You know, that's why I defend the DPRK, as unpopular as it may be with the trendy left, right? I defend Syria. I defend Russia. Not to say everything's perfect. Not to say I 100% agree, but just to say that those peoples have been fucked up by U.S. imperialism. As Chris said, there's no country in the world that can say, oh yeah, we're free from U.S. imperialism, like fucking us over. In some way, somehow, all these countries have been fucked over. So that's kind of how I see it. But, you know, Mitch, any final thoughts from you? Like, what advice do you have for people like us who are having these conversations? What do you think is going to happen next? And what is the role of communists, of leftists, progressives in the belly of the beast moving forward now that we have this real threat of war coming?
Yeah, I want to reiterate reiterate the quote from Marx and Engels that Lenin reiterated that I mentioned earlier. No nation can be free if it oppresses other nations. So our duty in the belly of the beast, if we want the liberty and the democracy and equality to which we aspire, is to oppose our country's oppression of other nations, right? And so that doesn't mean, you know, necessarily being on board with the United Russia Party's platform. But what it does mean is, first and foremost, before condemning any other nation, any other country, is that the country that we are a part of, we should condemn our military's action, that military being, you know, the largest military in the world, bigger than Russia and China, and I think the next three countries combined, right? So our primary duty is to oppose any kind of invasion or intervention by the United States. We've seen this play out time and time again, and then it actually made me think about when you brought up the Netflix picture. I do understand that Obama actually has some kind of partnership with Netflix right now, and he made sort of an anti-China documentary about a Chinese factory that came into America, but that's besides the point. But what I was thinking of was the White Helmets documentary that won an Academy Award the year that it came out. And that was another one of these, oh, look how humanitarian, look how wonderful these people are. Well, it turns out White Helmets is a front group for Al-Qaeda, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, so Al-Qaeda won an Academy Award that year, which is you know,
right.
So and I think we need to keep in mind when we have conversations with people, especially online, but I think it's more importantly in person, because this is where conversations really happen, is face to face. We have to remember that COINTELPRO didn't stop, and that the tactics are still being used, right? And so don't assume that the people that you talk to online are real people who are interested in debating in good faith, right? There are tons of people who are sock puppets for, you know, the deep state, whether it be, you know, the CIA or State Department or whatever, that are working to shift the dialogue on the left. And that's in counterintelligence programs documents from the 1960s. That's their goal. They wanted to infiltrate left-wing organizations and shift the dialogue, right? That's something that actually Gloria Steinem was very open about, her work with the CIA. So we shouldn't forget that's still going on. It hasn't stopped. In fact, not only has it not stopped, it's heightened. It's to an even higher level than it was in the 60s and 70s now, especially with the digital platforms and everything like that. It's that much easier, right? So I want to reiterate that, you know, I think the duty of anti-imperialists in the U.S. is, you know, not to follow the lines of any countries in conflict, but to build and present an independent program that presents peace, solidarity, anti-imperialism, and socialism as the answer to these problems first and foremost.
Beautifully said. And again, we want to reiterate our demands that we're uniting around: hands off Russia, no to NATO, no to Ukrainian fascism, solidarity with Donetsk, Luhansk, Crimea, Donbass, money for jobs and education, not wars and occupation. Don't fall for the lies. Please do not fall for the lies. We don't want to see a repeat of Iraq, of Yugoslavia, of Syria. We don't need wars. We don't need another war. We have plenty of problems in the U.S. that we need to deal with. And if we fall into the trap that we need to go in and save Ukraine and kill Putin and overthrow Russia, we're really fucked, honestly. And it's something that we have to remember. We always have to remember. And even like in the intro of the stream, Che Guevara's speech on imperialism, every time I listen to it, I always remember what he says. Never trust imperialism, not even this much, not even this much, because they always, always find new ways to deceive us. They always find new ways to try to get us into their wars. And we always have to avoid it at any cost. And remember that the primary contradiction is imperialism. The primary enemy is on Wall Street and in Washington. It is not in Moscow and Beijing. And that's something that we have to remember moving forward. It's been a real pleasure speaking with you, comrades. I'd love to have both of you on. Mitch is an editor of Middle Eastern Marx and the Journal of American Studies. He is a public health worker, historian, and member of the Party for Socialism and Liberation. Shout out to PSL and Midwestern Marx, based in Rochester. Mitch, is there a way people can follow your content? Anything you want to pitch before we head out?
Yeah, I'm hitherto existing on Instagram. Check out my stuff on Midwestern Marx, and check out PSL Finger Lakes.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Mitch. I definitely would love to have you back on the stream. Awesome. And shout out to my compañero Carlos Garrido and also Eddie from Midwestern Marx, who connected me to Mitch. You are awesome. Keep up the great work with Midwestern Marx. Really have a great channel, a great content they're producing. And also, last but not least, homie, my brother Chris out in New Jersey, student and community organizer working with Freedom Wall New Jersey with Chilean, Ukrainian, Soviet roots. Revolutionary activist and student at NYU. Chris, anything you want to pitch or promote before you head out?
Not really. I think the only thing that I really want to plug is for people to get connected with political prisoner campaigns in the United States, specifically, well, for New Jersey, Sundiata Okoli, who was a comrade of Assata Shakur. There's a push for him to be released in his elder age, and people should really check out his website. I think is you can look up sundiatacoli.org and find that. Also look up the National Jericho Movement website, and when it comes to building a movement here and building, you know, a political consciousness here that is based in anti-imperialism, that is based in socialism, that's a great place to start and a great place to connect to any organizing spaces that people might be getting into wherever they are.
Beautifully said. And as Comrade Erica said, free Sundiata, free all political prisoners, free them all. Shout out to Comrade Mike, free Alex Saab. Of course, shout out to the Bolivarian Revolution, to our comrades in Venezuela. Shout out to Compañero Yamir, revolutionary greetings from NYC. And also free Reverend Joy Powell, as Mitch said as well. Shout out to Comrade Saheli, Orinoco Tribune. Make sure to follow Orinoco Tribune. They have excellent content based in Venezuela, a Latin American revolutionary perspective. Thank you, comrades, so much for watching, listening. I appreciate y'all. I hope to have y'all back on the stream soon. You guys are awesome. No to NATO, hands off Russia. Yankee, go home. Get the fuck out of everywhere. Leave the peoples of the world alone. We're going to go out to some anti-fascist music from the Soviet era. Peace out, everybody. Have a great night.
Stamattina mi sono alzato. Oh, bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao. Stamattina mi sono alzato. Io ho trovato l'invasor. Partigiano, portami via. Oh, bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao. Partigiano, portami via, che mi sento di morir.
Partigiano, portami via, che mi sento di morir.
Se io muoio, do partigiano, bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao. Se io muoio da partigiano, tu mi devi seppellir. Seppellire sulla montagna.
Oh, bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao.
Seppellire sulla montagna, sotto l'ombra d'un bel fior.
Seppellire sulla montagna, sotto l'ombra d'un bel fior.
E le genti che passeranno,
oh bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao.
E le genti che passeranno, ti diranno che bel fior. Questo fiore del partigiano,
oh, bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, ciao, ciao.
Questo fiore del partigiano, morto per la libertà.